you by UNCF and the Ad Council.
Welcome to another edition of Real Family Talk. This is your host, Jay Real. Hope everybody's having a great Tuesday night.
Hello, 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 hello. Welcome to Real Family Talk. This is your host, Jay Real. Hope you're having a great Wednesday evening out there. This is, like I said, Real Family Talk, man. It's going to be heated in here tonight. We're going to have a good time, man. We got a couple guests that typically don't join us, but I asked them to join us tonight, and they graciously came through for us, so I appreciate that. But let's go ahead and talk about who's in the building. Jeremy's in the building. How you doing tonight, Jeremy?
I'm good. How you doing out there? Good people in WOKB land, Orlando, Florida, Central Florida, and everywhere else hearing us.
The WOKB land, huh? Chris, y'all gonna get you, bro. Mr. King's in the building. How you doing, Mr. King?
All right. Indeed, I'm full. Doing great. Ready for everybody out there in WOKB land, I guess.
And so, and we got Jason Henry's in the building. Jason doesn't usually come on the third week, but he's here tonight, man. We appreciate him coming out. How you doing, Jason?
I'm good, man. What about you?
I'm doing well, man. I got no complaints. Yesterday wasn't that great, but today was a whole lot better.
It's a whole new day.
And we got a young lady in the building with us tonight as well. Miss Shanice, is that right?
Yes.
How you doing? You doing all right?
I'm grand.
She's grand. She's new. So we'll take it easy. But just jump right in. If you got something you want to say, that's how we do it here at Real Family Talk. If you want to say it, say it. And we will make room for you. But also joining us tonight as well, we have I'm a doctor from lives out in California. I forget the school that he teaches at.
USC.
How you can forget that? The USC. Yeah, he teaches at USC. He's going to be joining us as well, Dr. Jody Almer. And he will be on the line soon here. But what are we talking about, man? We're talking about what everybody's talking about. We're talking about Ferguson. We're talking about what's happening in Ferguson, Missouri, man. That's what we're going to discuss tonight. 407-894-1680 is the number, 407-894-1680. I'd love to hear from you, hear your thoughts on what's happening in Missouri, what's happening with the case. Because it seems like every day there's new thing unfolding. And every day it just seems like it's getting worse than the next day, you know. Every day we got something new coming, and it's crazy what's happening in Missouri. I wonder, is it Missouri or the Middle East? I'm trying to figure that out real still. But
look at the pictures, you can't tell.
You really can't. I see Dr. Armour's on the line with us tonight. How you doing, Doctor?
Good to be back with you, man.
Ah, we appreciate it. Thank you for joining us.
I wish it could be under more auspicious circumstances, but, you know, this is what we need to be talking about 24/7. You know, we can talk about auspicious stuff another time. This is what people are living and breathing and sometimes not breathing because of every day, so we need to get on it.
All right, I agree. Let me hear, what are your thoughts about the shooting in general and what's happening in Ferguson?
Yeah, well, Ferguson is a symptom. It's a part of a pattern. You know, I wrote a book in 1997, A Negrophobia and Reasonable Racism, The Hidden Cost of Being Black in America, that was talking about the Bernard Goetz case, celebrated subway vigilante case, where he shot four black youth as they were trying to run out of a subway away from him, and he was acquitted by a jury making a valid self-defense claim. Amadou Diallo, African exchange student standing in a vestibule in New York, and four plainclothes cops unloaded, I think it was 39 or 41 bullets went in his direction. I think 19 hit him, and they were all acquitted. And so I was writing the book about those incidents in 1997 and trying to come to grips with them. Here we are in 2004, and all I can tell my students is, ain't nothing changed but the year it is. That's all. In terms of the analysis, in terms of the incident, in terms of what's going on, nothing has changed fundamentally. You know, we like to tell ourselves a little story, a little bedtime story about progress in America and racial progress and things getting better. Well, yeah, things are a lot better. for people like Obama and people like Holder and people like me in the middle class or upper middle class or professional class or whatever you want to call it. Things have never been better for those blacks in America ever. But, you know, when I just came back from San Quentin 2 weeks ago, and I'm talking to brothers doing 40 years for nothing in a cell that's, you know, 4x8, two beds in that cell, you know. And I'm thinking for these black men, times have never been worse. You know, we're talking about mass bondage, not just mass incarceration. We need to call it what it is, mass bondage. You know, and so what Ferguson represents is the frustration, the resentment, the despair of the truly disadvantaged black America that Obama doesn't represent, Holder doesn't represent, and I don't really represent. You know, there are not only two Americas, there are two black Americas. And so, you know, I'm looking out over the L.A. skyline now and thinking, you know, here's where this has been the epicenter of uprisings by black folk over social justice issues, especially with regard to the police. And the Watts riots in 1965, it was the biggest riot in the civil rights era right here in L.A., and then the 92 riots triggered by the Rodney King beating right here in L.A., uprising, you know, mass, there's lots of deaths, lots of mass property damage. And it was all about the exact same fact pattern we're talking about today. So it's not just Missouri. It's not just Ferguson. It's across the country, New York. You know, we can go around the nation and say again and again, ain't nothing changed but the year.
Now, Professor Jordan Armour from USC is joining us tonight. The question that I have for you is that this is representative of something larger. This isn't just, you know, outrage being shown towards the killing of another young black man. Poverty in Ferguson has increasingly gotten worse since 2000. Some of the numbers that I saw said that 44% of the residents or the communities in Ferguson live below the poverty line. So it's not just you know, outwardly showing anger toward, you know, police officer killing a black man. This is representative of something larger. Do you agree with that?
Oh, no question. Absolutely. You know, what you have is a cry of despair against, you know, against the kind of hopelessness that a lot of folks have to live under. You know, in my neighborhood here, for example, in Crenshaw, the high school, local high school, lost its accreditation 2005-06. You know, if you're a black kid who played by all the rules and went to school and did everything you were supposed to do, and You look up and they tell you that your diploma is worth toilet tissue in the admissions process because it came from an unaccredited high school. Mm-hmm. So you just realize you've been sold a cruel hoax. And the legitimate means to the American dream have been cut off to you. And then people are going to sit around and wag their finger at you and talk about personal responsibility and not talk about social accountability of a nation that has failed them as a generation, as a group. And so, yeah, what we have are people saying that as black Americans, especially truly disadvantaged black Americans, that's what we got to, there's a serious class dimension to this discussion that can't be forgotten. Mm-hmm. They're saying that truly disadvantaged black America is in desperate straits. You know, everybody wants to talk about everything but this set of issues, you know, the grinding poverty, instead of the structural inequality, mm-hmm. the unconscious bias. Now, everybody wants to talk about anything but that, and they want to make it clear that their pain and suffering is not going to continue to go on in silence and forever. You know, and so that is what we're seeing, and we have to see in those terms. So, for example, you know, I was having a very helpful discussion today with former police chief Bernard Parks. Now he's a city council person, mm-hmm. Also a black man, of course. Mark right. Ridley Thomas is a black county supervisor for the county of LA, so he has responsibility for the county sheriff's department, as Parks has responsibility for LAPD. And I was also talking to, you know, some editors with the L.A. Times, and what we were kind of sitting back and trying to come to grips with Parks and with, you know, with Ridley Thomas, et cetera, is what is going on here when it comes to police profiling young black males? Well, it's a complicated issue. It's not, you know, we used to be able to say back in the Jim Crow days that racism is easy to identify. You know, sure. You have Archie Bunker, you have Bull Connors, you have your avowedly virulent racist, and you point to him and he's easy to identify.
And it's right. Harder
today,
now.
Yeah, police will say, hey, you know what? I profile black guys because black guys are disproportionately involved in crime.
Right.
There's a statistically valid relationship between race and risk of criminality. They'll say, look at the FBI crime statistics, mm-hmm. You know, and they have a point to a large degree there, right? You take a group of people and you disproportionately concentrate them in desperate circumstances, and it should sadden but not surprise you that they may disproportionately turn to desperate undertakings like crime.
Right.
You know, most people, when I went to San Quentin, over 80% of the criminals in those kinds of prison, and some reports say it's as high as 90% of those inmates come from families below the poverty line. So either people are poor because they're bad, which doesn't make sense, or they're bad because they're poor.
Absolutely.
That makes a lot more sense. You put people in grinding poverty and criminogenic conditions, they're going to turn disproportionately to crime. So,
what
that means is that race is not irrational to consider race. You know, when Jesse Jackson says, nothing more troubles me at this point in my life, to an all-black Chicago camp congregation, when Jackson says, nothing more bothers me at this point in my life than to walk down the street, start hearing suspicious footsteps and thinking robbery, turn around, see someone white and feel relieved, right? That's Jesse Jackson telling the truth, right? A hard truth,
yeah.
But a truth we got to acknowledge and say, what are we going to do about that? You know, that crime that we disproportionately engage in is a result of the structural economic inequality that we suffered for 250, 300 years. Crime is a product of our social history in this country. I understand that there may be some statistical basis to that profiling that still doesn't make it acceptable. We're still not going to accept it.
Now, do you think that the other side of this argument that we always hear when we face situations of this nature, we heard it with Trayvon Martin, we actually heard it with Sean Bell, we heard it with Oscar Grant, is that, you know, we show outrage toward incidents of this nature, but when it comes to black-on-black crime, you know, we don't march, we don't sing, we don't protest. When we do, in reality we do, it's just not broadcast on a national level. But do you think injecting that argument into this conversation is problematic? Because those two aren't mutually exclusive. You can have police brutality, you know, towards African-American males and have a problem with black-on-black crime. That doesn't mean we're not outraged about both, but should we inject that conversation into this one? Black-on-black crime is separate from this. So do you think it's problematic to try to tie both of them in into the same conversation?
Yeah, it's problematic, but all too predictable.
Yeah.
They do it every time. I'm telling you, right? They trot this out every time. It's called changing the subject.
Mm-hmm.
Let's not talk about racism still being a big part of the American fabric and running through the police system and all across America. We want to deny racism as a big influential factor in American life still, many of these people are saying. So let's talk not about, you know, any of that stuff, but let's talk about black-on-black crime and why you're not getting upset about that. So they're going to trot out that predictable old canard over and over, and we got to be ready for it, and we got to shut them down on it. And here's how you shut them down on it. You tighten them up on it, right? You say, what we're talking about is an officer who's given a badge and a gun, a monopoly on legitimate violence, and takes an oath of office to discharge his duties constitutionally. He puts his hand up voluntarily. Nobody puts a gun in his head and says, take this oath of office. No, and when he takes that office, he takes it in trust. He's a trustee, all right? And he has to faithfully live up to the rules and obligations of that office because he speaks for all of us. He does his job, she does her job for all of us. They are our agents. And so when they go out, these police officers, and commit discrimination and kill people in part because of racial bias of any kind, they are killing in our name. A gangbanger doesn't kill in our name, that doesn't take an oath of office, isn't a trustee acting in trust for us. So we need to just shut that down and get back to the topic at hand, right, at when they bring that up. You know, make it real clear that when police officers kill unjustly, they make all of us, they kill in our name and make all of us participate in their public injustice. That doesn't happen with a gangbanger.
I think that's suitable.
I think
participators,
that is,
yeah.
Yeah. I got a question. One of the things that we talked about this last week a little bit, too, and one of the things I mentioned is I think a lot of this has to do with the, I call it the fear of the black man, that especially law enforcement officials, you know, when they see it, you know, especially let's say white officers, when they see a black person or black man in particular, they typically don't really know how to respond. And then if you look at the reports, you know, what the statistics say and all that stuff, you know, it all suggests that potentially every black man you meet is probably going to hurt you, if you will. That's the way they present it anyway. And so I think a lot of it just has to do with that fear. And it's like, well, I don't know what he's going to do. He's coming close, you know, pop, 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 you know, and it's like, all right, I guess I'm safe now, you know. What do you think about that, Doctor?
Hey, well, you know what? There's little doubt in my mind that that's the case. And that's why I don't think that the problem is solved simply by getting more black officers, because black officers, you know, some of these studies show that both blacks and whites unconsciously absorb a lot of negative stereotypes about blacks and can respond on their basis. When I was down at JW Marriott, for example, a couple months back in LA Live, downtown LA, you know, swank restaurant, I'm meeting my guy from high school there, and I'm approached by three guards, one of them black, who ask me, who am I there to see? And I say, well, my friend Lino Garcia, the general manager of ESPN Deportes, but why are you asking me and not anyone else in the office, in the lobby? And they say, well, sir, we've been having a problem with transients. And I say, well, I look like a transient? And this is the black guy they sent over to me now, right? The two white guys stand back.
To try to soften
the black guy, and I say, I look like a transient? And he says, don't take it personally, right? So, you know, we can have what they're seeing in these studies, and that's what makes this problem so tough. Forget the statistical stuff, right? Whether there's a statistically rational relation between race and risk of crime, and so that may provide some, you know, basis for profiling. Let's go over here to what the psychology of race. You know, here's your brain on race. Here's race, here's your brain on race. And here's what they're finding in the psychological studies, that our brains on race, whether we're black or white, are such that when you see some ambiguous black person, you are much more likely to mistake an ambiguous object in their hand for a gun than a similarly situated white person. Automatically, unconsciously, even if you're a racially liberal person,
you've already developed a bias.
Right?
Yeah.
And so it's not just a problem of bigots going out here looking to do bad things. This is a problem that comes out of the American cultural belief system that we all swim around in, and we all have these unconscious biases. So now, and not only did they find that in these studies, Jennifer Eberhard up at Stanford Law School has done a lot of this work. I recommend, you know, Googling her. Not only have they found that you're more likely to think that a black person is an assailant, an ambiguous black person is an assailant, than a similarly situated white person, but the blacker they are, the darker they are, the more likely you're to think they are menacing, the more likely you're to mistake the object for something ambiguous, a weapon, number one, and the more wicked you're likely to think they are. In other words, the more death-worthy when they look at death penalty cases. So, you know, when I was growing up, it used to be the blacker the berry, the dark, the sweeter the juice, and no doubt that's true. But what these studies show is, for many Americans, the blacker the berry, the scarier the juice.
Oh,
you
my
know?
Gosh, yeah.
And what they're worried about is juice on the loose. You know, black males, you know, do unconsciously, for Americans, to generate these mental reflexes, right, that make them think that we are, you know, more menacing, et cetera. And so what do you do about that? You know, that's a humongous problem that's not going to be solved by changing the demographics of a particular police department in Ferguson, Minnesota.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because I saw a study where I've heard that exact same argument that we need more African-American police officers or minority police officers to try to correct this so-called issue. But a recent study that I saw said that of all local law enforcement agencies, 83% of them are white. So is this obviously isn't a problem that's pertinent to just Ferguson. This happens nationwide. But even if we were to add more individuals or more individuals of color to local law enforcement agencies, this wouldn't necessarily correct the problem. So how do we get to the heart of, maybe I shouldn't say fixing the issue, but at least broaching it? Absolutely.
No, I love that. That's it. You know, let's get to the heart. To get to the heart of it is to make sure that our hearts are connected to the hearts of our young black males, mm-hmm. which they aren't. We're us in the black community, our black leadership. You know, we got to take care of caring more for, you know, our own, just in that respect, because what my research has recently uncovered is how many black leaders have been involved in this mass incarceration of black males.
Way too many.
You know, from Charlie Rangel, mm-hmm. standing there and signing the 1986 Anti-Drug Abuse Act with Reagan, that created the 100-to-1 powder to crack disparity in sentencing, mm-hmm. and mandatory minimums for the first time. Over half the Congressional Black Caucus voted for that legislation in 1986. Check it out.
CBC.
All the way up to here in the county of L.A., the D.A., Jackie Alacy, a black woman who's just assumed the office of D.A., you know, she tried a 18-year-old black male who has a 16-year-old snatched two purses. You know, some brothers, you know, if they're hungry, they do snatch purses to persevere, mm-hmm. as Jay-Z said, right? Mm-hmm. So he did, yes, when he was 16, snatch a couple purses, and then at 18, took a cell phone from the back seat of an unoccupied car in a Target parking lot. You know, she tried him and got a conviction against him for 25 to life.
What?
And then when the judge, in a rare feat of, you know, judicial intervention, said, no, that just shocks the conscience, I'm going to knock it down to 7 years, still seven for taking a cell phone, she objected and said, no, it should be 25 to life, right? So those are black folks. I just named a lot of black folks who have made these kinds of assaults on our own community. We've hobbled a generation of blacks. We black folks, not just the rest of the general America. So we got to get our heads straight. We got to get clear in our thinking and stop, you know, some of the ways we've been approaching one another and the ways we've been approaching social problems, talking about personal responsibility and locking people up, mm-hmm. and law and order. But that needs to change.
And part of the problem is I think there's a generational divide here as well, where, you know, you have a lot of young leaders who are willing and ready to step up, but then you have a lot of the old guard, old civil rights leaders who don't want to let go. So, for example, Jesse Jackson was in Ferguson, and as he's talking, he asked for $100 to help, $100 donation to help training at his church, and they booed him off the stage. So if that's the face of the old guard, and then the face that they are trying to depict of the so-called new leaders is that they're looting and rioting, how do you bridge that gap? Martin Luther King said that, you know, rioting is the language of the unheard. So if you have a lot of young brothers who are hurting, and then you have the old generation who, you know, isn't necessarily bridging that gap, absolutely, how do we fix that bridge?
Yeah, well, you're right. I hear you about the old guard. You know, we have had, and before I jump to that, my story about the old guard, the new guard, you know, you young lions and lionesses coming up, got to be clear in your thinking so you don't just replace the old guard, mm-hmm. with new guard, but it's, you know, it's old wine and new bottle. You know, you got to radically transform, you know, what liquid is going into these bottles. Mm-hmm. But you're right about the old guard, because I'm thinking about Donald Sterling out here in L.A. and how the NAACP pimped its imprimatur to Donald Sterling, right? It's used its good name to allow Donald Sterling to achieve some kind of absolution for all the discriminating he was doing in his housing unit by making him the person of the, you know, Lifetime Achievement Award.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the NAACP giving Donald Sterling Lifetime Achievement Awards so he can absolve himself and look like some kind of, you know, racially progressive person, right? So the old guard has proven has proven itself, unfortunately, too often to be bankrupt in squaring its, you know, its actions with its profession. So, yeah, I'm feeling you 100% on, you know, new blood, new ideas, but it needs to be new ideas with the new blood, not just new blood with some same old ideas. We have new blood coming in talking the same personal responsibility and just pull your pants up and that's all, and keep a dad in the home. Obama didn't have a dad in the home, and he's president of the United States. What he had was a middle-class background. He went to the best private high school in Honolulu, and then to Columbia, then to Harvard. When that's going for you, a lot of that other stuff isn't nearly as important.
I really feel that education definitely would bridge the gap also. A lot of our young lion and lionesses, as you call them, they don't really have the education, and they're not really actually interested in learning from the old heads. And I really think that's what really would bridge the gap, because once they know where they came from, they can know where they're trying to go and where we're trying to go. But they're not getting the education nor the knowledge that they need to actually replace these people that have been there for years.
I feel you. You know, we some of that's on us. You know, we gotta be. I've been listening to struggle music lately. You know, I've been listening to rebel music. You know, Bob Marley, Babylon System. You know, survival and all that. And you know, I thinking that some of that through. I've been listening to some of the Sam Cooke. You know, A Change Gonna Come. Kind of thing, and looking at Spike Lee's old footage from Malcolm X,
yeah,
the movie. You know, now Malcolm moved people. You know, he made you feel good about learning, about thinking. He said to be a strong black man means to be smart and clear and sharp. You know, we need that. You know, we need to you know, bring that back to these young folk. You know, making it clear the link between, you know, being a strong woman, a strong man, a strong person, a strong African American, a strong black person, and being able to run circles around a lot of these Lilliputians out here, you know, hunting.
I like that.
You know, like X-Clan used to say, chili and magilla, chocolate and vanilla. How can polar bears swing on vines with a gorilla? Please.
You know, Professor, and again, this is Professor Jody Armour from USC. How do you think, or what do you think of the president's response to this? Because he's received a little bit of criticism due to how tepid he's been. Obviously, his response has been wrapped in what's going on in Iraq and ISIS and what's happened with the American journalist over there. How do you think his response has been? Do you think it's appropriate? Do you think he should show more outrage? Do you think the criticism of him has been just?
Yeah, you know, I can't expect a whole lot more of him right now. You know, he's doing a lot of things. I'm looking more for his actions, his deeds, than his words. He's very good at speechifying. Sometimes he goes too far at places like Morehouse. We wagged his fingers at him, talked to him about personal responsibility. These very accomplished young black men as they go out into the world. But, you know, what I'm looking at more is these. You know, I'm asking myself, why in the first administration did you have Eric Holder coming out here fighting decriminalization of marijuana in California? We could have been like Colorado and Washington State now. Mm-hmm. And one of the big reasons police shake down young black males is marijuana. You know, it's one of those, you know, gateway little offenses. That if you're concerned about mass incarceration, if you're concerned about these truly disadvantaged, we've been talking about these two black Americas, you should make mass incarceration number one agenda on your presidential list. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when we're talking about in some of these inner city neighborhoods, 90%, and I wrote that in this book I just wrote because I was quoting it from a distinguished case book. In some of these inner city neighborhoods, 90% of young black men are going to wind up in jail, on probation, or on parole at some point in their lives. If that's not the number one issue on your agenda, Mr. President, if that's not our hair on fire, then I don't know what is. But then why in your first administration aren't you doing things in line with that? Why do you have Holder coming out here and fueling the drug war. Now it's stepping back some. Now you're doing something. You're making some noises. But I'm looking for more than symbolism. I'm looking for, you know, the reality, on-the-ground action. You know, what can we do to end some of this crying distress that, these black communities are in from mass incarceration and these other, things that we've been talking about. But my focus now, just coming from back from San Quentin a couple weeks ago, man, is mass incarceration. If you see some of the conditions that they got us locked up in, you know, I'm talking about 4x8, 2 beds, you know, over and over. And you're stuck in there. When they go into lockdown, you're in there 24 hours straight up. You know, you're only allowed to flush the toilet sometimes twice a day because they're having water problems. You know, you can't imagine the stench and the confinement and the darkness and the dimness and the, you know, and that's where, you know, we're talking about mass numbers of us in that situation. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's, I want to see some action from the president along those lines. I don't care so much about the pretty rhetoric right now. You know, he's getting ready to, the shadows are growing long on his administration.
Yeah, very.
You know, he's near the end. It's just the sunset. So just let show out. Let's see what you got. You know, in terms of actions, I don't care much about the other stuff right now.
Hmm. Well, Professor, I really want to thank you again for joining us. You gave us a solid 20 minutes, man. I appreciate that.
For sure.
Hey, absolutely. It's always good talking to you, brother.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Man.
Thank you for joining us tonight. I do want one more question for you.
Yeah.
Well, as it relates to what they're doing in Ferguson, obviously the governor's called for the National Guard. We know they've been looting and they haven't been able to control everything. And so now he's called for the National Guard to come in. What do you think? I mean, what do you think the long-term effects will that be on those people to know that pretty much they're being, policed now by Army or Marines or wherever
well,
they called
them
up from?
I feel you, man, but a lot of us have felt in the black community out here, I'm speaking for L.A. now, for right now, okay, I'll just start here. A lot, when you listen to N.W.A., they're getting ready to do a biopic on N.W.A. The reason N.W.A. came up with F the Police, I'll put it that way since we're on the radio, but the reason they use that profane language to talk about what was happening to them in the mid to late 80s is because they felt like the LAPD was an occupying force. In the community, and they were already feeling that way. Even without all the National Guard trappings or all of that, any of that, they already felt like, we're with an occupying force. And I had a someone with up in the higher brass of the LAPD at a recent town hall meeting I moderated when the LAPD broke up a black graduation party last year with 79 riot police and helicopters, even though a white party right across the street was left undisturbed, and the students came down and testified to that effect at the town hall meeting before 1,000 other students and cameras, et cetera. At the time that, we were having that kind of military intervention from the police department here, a lot of people were saying, what is NWA talking about? There can't be that much antagonism between, the black community. Ice Cube was saying in 89, America's Most Wanted, he was prophesying the 92 riots. He was saying, the way you are occupying us is that. So this higher up in this town hall meeting said in the 80s and 90s, he said this to 1,000 students on camera. He said, in the 80s and 90s, we were taught, in early aughts, our approach was, really 80s and 90s, a paramilitary approach. We took a paramilitary approach, a broken windows approach. We were told that if somebody spit on the sidewalk or jaywalked, they were down on the concrete, face down. That's how we policed the communities in the 80s and 90s.
Mm-hmm.
All right? And he said, now, under the consent decree that the LAPD went with, the Department of Justice and LAPD entered, there's been a lot of more, there's been a move toward community policing. That needs to be what we talk about more, away from broken windows policing and paramilitary approaches to community policing. And a lot of that has improved, even though we still have these incidents. So
you know, a lot of our communities already feel like we are just being occupied by you know, forces not there to serve and protect, but to contain and control.
Okay. And one last question for you, Doctor. EZEL 4, what's happening with the EZEL 4? I mean, that's kind of being pushed under the radar with everything happening in Ferguson right now. But of course, that just happened as well. What are they saying out there in L.A.?
Man, you know, it is it's a steady stream of those kinds of incidents, man. This is the one we're talking about now, but there's another one over in Pasadena where, you know, guy Kendrick McDade, you know, was shot under just a very, you know, unsettling circumstances by a police officer. So it's almost, you know, so constant, you know, there's almost a carbon copy monotony to it. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just if it's not this brother, it's another brother. You know, now it's a sister. Now, and they disproportionately, all truly, not all, but disproportionately truly disadvantaged young brothers and sisters. You know, and that's the big divide. So, you know, it's stirring some controversy, but we need to go beyond just, you know, feeling stirred and start getting, like Malcolm X would say, let's get real clear. Let's get clarity on what time it is, on what really is going on, not be distracted by things like all of this personal responsibility talk, you know, and really get at the macro level social factors that are determining our condition, you know, jobs, crumbling schools, you know, sufficient health care, the basic kinds of things really give people opportunities and connect means to end, you know, legitimate means to the American dream. Let's focus on that, and if we get clarity on that, you know, we can maybe get to the bottom of some of this.
All right. That's Dr. Jody Armour, folks. Dr. Jody Armour. Anything you want to plug, Doctor?
I heard you had a new book, man. What's the book?
Yeah, hey. You know, it's in the review process, so, you know, next time I talk to you, I hope to say that it's coming out on such and such date, but it's about mass incarceration, blame and punishment, you know, the attempt to distinguish between good Negroes and bad Negroes within the black community and within American society more generally. So, man, we'll definitely get down about that next time we chat.
Definitely. Hit me up on, hit us up on Twitter, Real Family Talk, and let us know when it's out. We'll definitely bring you back. Not a problem. Anytime. We thank you, Doctor, for joining us tonight. Dr. Jody Armour, ladies and gentlemen. Dr. Jody Armour. We appreciate that. Gentlemen, ladies, Ferguson, Missouri, Dr. Armour certainly laid it out for us. A lot going on. They just actually, I'm sure you probably paid attention, they just killed another young man in St. Louis just a couple of days ago. That story basically plays out. They say the young man went into a convenience store. They say that, I guess he was kind of acting erratically in the convenience store, and he took some stuff out of the convenience store, stole some stuff, brought it out, then kind of went back in, apparently, came back out, and
he had a knife.
Yeah, by the time he came back out the second time with the stuff, they had called the police. The police showed up, and then he was walking. I guess the police were on one side of the corner, if you will. He was on the other. He saw the police, basically went to his side, pulled up a knife, and they say he basically told the police, what you gonna do, shoot me? Go ahead. Something to that nature. And so he began to charge or walk. I don't know if he was walking, running, whatever, but he began to come closer to wherever the police were with knife in hand. They warned him, you know, sir, you need to back up with that knife. He kept coming. Next thing you know, a couple of shots later, he's dead.
Now, see, that I don't agree with, because that's why they got tasers. That's why they have things that they don't have to shoot. They even got rubber bullets. So it's multiple ways that they could have taken care of that situation without killing a brother. You could have shot him in the leg. You could have shot him in the arm with the knife. But mainly, you have a taser for that situation. You could have shot him with the taser, shot him with a couple of volts. He would have been down the ground, and so would have the knife. Case closed.
There's such a divide here. You always hear, I think Chris Rock said it in the mid 90s or late 90s. He said, oh, a black man was shot. He was like, no, a person was shot in the arm. That must be a white guy. It's like, yeah, you see, if they're shot in the arm or the leg or something non-vital, then it's a white person. You shoot him in the head, in the neck, or in an organ, it's a black person.
Well, they don't shoot black people in organs. The police are actually trained not to shoot you in your organs because you may be an organ donor.
Yeah, so they can harvest them.
There you go. So, no, they didn't shoot him in the organs.
But that's, I mean, that's what I'm saying.
Not a black man.
And the divide here to me is interesting because you have one side that's saying, and obviously this is along racial lines, one side that's saying, let's wait until the investigation plays out. We still haven't seen the video, the dashboard, and they released the video of that guy being shot and killed today.
Right.
We still haven't seen any video of what happened with Michael Brown.
And you won't.
And exactly. You probably will never probably see
won't.
That.
You won't.
And you have one side that's saying, let's wait until the police investigation plays out so we can see what happened. And then the other side is like, nah. Even if he stole every single item in that convenience store, why did you have to shoot and kill him?
Right.
And the second part of that is, you didn't even know he was a robbery suspect. You just told him to get the F out of the street. Why did you even have to approach him with that type of language anyway? So if I'm walking down the street and there's a sidewalk, could you say, you know what, sir, could you just please move over to the sidewalk? Instead of saying, get the F out the street, what would your reaction be?
I mean, I feel like they feel like that's the only thing we understand.
But see, that's the problem. Right. Like, that gets to the heart of the problem. So if that's what we're facing, where if I'm just walking down the street and I have the chance of being blown away, shot and killed in all daylight on the hot pavement. So, that's the problem. Like, how do we, you can't fix that. If that's embedded, you can't fix that.
So you want the police department to have groups that teach the white police officers
how
to deal with black people.
No.
Is that what you want?
No.
Because the thing about it is, you have Caucasians and you have African Americans that have different personalities. You know, every African-American acts completely different from every European. Yeah. And they act different, so they don't know how to handle us. So until we get some kind of focus groups, they can teach them,
I disagree with that. But the reason why is because they're not open to hearing what you have to say.
Well, that's true, too.
They don't care.
And also, I think a focus group is not the issue. I think the bigger issue is, or the bigger way to try and solve that problem would be integration to some extent. And I'm not talking about forced integration, but in order to sort of feel empathy for somebody else, you have to first have some kind of understanding of who that person is, or potentially. And what I mean by that is, like, you know, you think about their police department in Ferguson. It's, what was 54 officers,
50 of them are white.
50 of them are white, you know, about four or five blacks. So the empathy right there is not really there, because more than likely they're not participating with one another, meaning the black officers and the white officers, the chances of them interacting is probably very low. Yeah. So perhaps if there was a way to integrate all the white officers somehow into, you know, seeing that, you know, every black person ain't finna hit you. You know what I'm saying? Even though he may be slightly aggressive towards you, he's not necessarily, you know, finna come after you or whatever the case may be. You know, but the only way you solve or can kind of get to the root of those issues is by integrating. We need to be around each other to be desensitized, or sensitized, I guess is a better word, to understanding how the other person may feel and react. I think that's one of the bigger issues that we have in this country, is you have black people on one side who feel a certain way, you have white people on the other side who feel a certain way, and nobody's really communicating or even empathizing with the other to really understand, you know, how you see and how we perceive the same America.
They don't know how to communicate with us. They feel that we get emotional, we get passionate, it's not aggressive, because it's mainly passion when we're talking. You know, they don't talk like that. They talk way more calmer. They talk differently, so that when they feel that when they come at us cussing like they do, that's their passion. You know, and that's how they show their type of passion. I mean, you know, we may do it like that, but then we'll be like, you know, don't even worry about it.
Yeah.
You know, it's not that serious, even though we showing passion, you know. Even last week when we was having our discussion about what we was talking about after the show, I forgot what it was.
Religion.
Wine. We were talking about wine. Let's go on. No. We're talking about y'all, too. Now, y'all, too, was yesterday with the wine. Now, any, you know, European that walked by and saw that, they would have swore y'all was about to fight. They would have thought y'all was going at each other's throats. But, you know, people who's grown up around African-Americans, we know, they just having a conversation. Like, you know, they just talking about something and they're passionate about it. So that's why I say they need to have something that teaches them how we operate. Because the only thing that they're learning about how we operate is what they see on television. And it's our fault that we are letting ourselves be depicted like that on television. Because what you see on Atlanta Housewives, what you see on Love and Hip Hop, what you see on TV that shows black African Americans is all that they have to go off of.
But you know what? The other side of that is I don't think that every white family is like Modern Family.
I do. Hey, I'm sorry. Hey. I do.
I don't think that every white family is like Modern Family or the community.
I'm sorry.
I don't think that.
I have a white stepmother. Mm-hmm. My dad married a white lady, and mm-hmm. I grew up with her and her two children that were European.
Yeah.
So, what's on TV? That's real.
But just like some people, Atlanta, that's real for some people too.
That's true.
Absolutely. But I'm saying our collective experiences cannot be duplicated, if that makes any sense. So if let's just say we turn this into a focus group and you got you white, you black, I'm white, you're Puerto Rican, and you throw, I don't know, Asian. An Italian or somebody in there. Asian. And we sit up here and we throw out, okay, you be in racial appetite, you be in racial appetite, and then we're just going to talk about how that makes you feel. Yeah, we can talk about that in the room, but once you go back out in the real world, you're going to remember what you talked about in the focus group?
How
would you even apply that?
It starts where this is how you handle the situation, because that's all they train the police. It ain't mm-hmm. about how you feel. It's about how you handle the situation.
Yeah.
So they need to have a young brother talk to them like, nah, man, you know, I'm just chilling. They don't know how to handle that
But they
situation.
Have that. Why do you think they have gang units that go through that type of training so that they can...
You really think the gang unit training...
No. I'm using that as an example.
Oh, okay.
Just an example that they have different types of training to have so that they are forced. I'll use the word forced to say, okay, yeah, I can empathize with that young brother. Yeah, because some black guy came in and told me that this is how you're supposed to feel. So let's just say I'm arresting you. And let's just say you get live and I'm like, okay, I was expecting this from somebody like you. What is your reaction going
to
be?
My reaction is to control the situation as calm as possible.
Maybe
but
I shouldn't,
what they
I
need to learn
I
is.
I should use you as an example.
Because you know I'm a sympathetic guy.
Yeah. So. No, maybe you're too educated for this.
Well, you know, I will show both sides.
I would think. That's why ratchet. I say, that's why I say you have to find a way for us, and what I mean by us, whites, blacks, whatever, we have to find ways for us to really interact, because I think that's the bigger issue, is that we really, even in 2014, we really still don't interact with each other, and so all we really know about each other, generally speaking, you know, besides, I'm talking common man, not the educated,
sure,
if you will, but the common man, all we really know about each other is what we see on TV, and so unfortunately. In general, we're typically not depicted in a great way on television. And so if that's all you know, which if you go to some of these, you know, there's a lot of places in the country where that really is all they know about black people,
yeah.
But they see it on TV.
Absolutely.
So when that's all you know, then that's your perception. And then these people move from their little towns. And then when they see us, they're like, ooh, okay, you must be like, oh boy, I saw on, you know, you must be like Stevie J, you know, or whatever the case may be. So it's about integration. We, you know, as families, we have to integrate more so that we can, you know, it's going to take a generation. It's not going to happen overnight.
Here's my problem with that.
The next generation can be
part of
a little
it.
Bit
I feel
different.
We're acquiescing to something. So whatever the cultural norm is supposed to be, that's what we're acquiescing to. So basically, that's what you're saying. In order for us to fit in, we need to figure out a way to better interact with each other so that white folk can better understand how we feel and the things that we go through. The other part of that is that what is wrong with African Americans feeling selfish about their reaction? So you heard, how many people do you hear say on the daily, why are they rioting? Why are they looting? Why are they stealing hair weaves? Why are they, who cares? They're angry.
They're angry.
I don't have to explain to any African American, any Anglo-Saxon about why I'm angry about why a white police officer just killed a black man. So why do we pull back from that? Why do you feel, or I'm not saying anybody in this room, but why do we feel the need to try to explain, okay, well, let me try to break it down for you why this, no, I'm angry. And I don't have to explain to you why I'm angry. I just need you to understand, or not even understand, but I just need you to move out of the way so that I can show you how angry I am. But why aren't we selfish about that? Why do we give that away? Why do we give that type of feeling away so easily, where we feel like we need to acquiesce to what white people think we should be.
Well, I think it, because it's not about what white people think we should be. It's about what we should be as people.
Thank you.
You know what I'm saying? Because as people, I can be angry about what happened in Ferguson.
Sure.
But I'm not going to go to Ferguson. If I was in Ferguson, I should say, I'm not going to go and throw a brick through the window because
sure.
I was angry.
Sure, absolutely not.
If I was in Ferguson.
You'd throw a brick through a window?
I would have been Mookie. With the trash can.
You know, but because I think it's not about white or black when you're talking about that. You can be angry all you want, but looting, you know, as a general principle, looting doesn't solve anything. And then two, it doesn't bring any closure for you. Yeah. It actually only makes everything that you're angry about even worse, which is what, you know, and what is that going to do? It's going to make you even angrier, because if you think about Ferguson, they're looting. What happened? The police presence got stronger. You know, they kept looting. What happened? The governor said, okay, the police can't handle this.
But
I'm going to bring in some
military.
I mean, it's not a people thing.
Yeah, I agree. I'm not saying that I condone rioting,
right.
But I'm saying there's reasoning behind it.
Right.
So I get it, but it's like, come on, dude, you got to think.
But still, you got to get your point shown, because it's over, like they say. It's the same thing being going on. It's just another year. So what are we going to do to get their attention? Because we got their attention now. But now what are we going to do now that we have their attention?
Unfortunately, I don't think we have.
That's because there's only two cities that's rioting.
Let
most of the black cities start rioting. I guarantee you, we're just not following suit. We're just like Brother Henry is saying, we like, well, why are you doing it? Instead of just being like, well, y'all doing it, we going to do it because we're going to get our voices heard.
Unfortunately, there's an attention, certainly on Ferguson. But the attention that they have is all negative right now.
Who cares?
Even though most of the people there are protesting peacefully,
mm-hmm.
even though the family and you know all of the leaders, the quote unquote black leaders that are going there to speak, are asking for peaceful protests, and for the most part that's happening.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, the attention that they have is still very, very negative. And as the days go by, the media is simply releasing stories to make the people there seem even more.
Listen,
negative.
You
don't have a focus.
Two cosmic events that happened in Ferguson that brought attention. Number one, a white reporter was arrested. That's mm-hmm. when you start to see the national media hit the Ferguson, because a white reporter was arrested.
Mm-hmm.
The second part of that is a white reporter on CNN said, why don't y'all just use water cannons on them? That'll get them under control. So, I mean, we're still dealing with a racist system,
yeah, right.
And we're trying to figure out how can we...
What's the way that
I should frame it? Yeah, how can we make sure that the racist system that's bringing all of this attention in the first place, because it wasn't just we're pissed off that Michael Brown was killed by a white cop. We're also pissed off that we have Trayvon Martin, Eric Garner, what's my man? Oscar Grant,
Ezell Ford.
The list goes on and on,
but it's not just that. It's that we have lack of economic opportunities.
Right,
we have redlining that happened back in the 60s that pushed us out because white people didn't want to live with us, and it was against the law to give us good mortgages. We're still talking about those things, and even integration. Integration has actually harmed us in a lot of ways.
Exactly.
But we're dealing with a system that wasn't designed to help you in the first place.
Exactly. It was set up for against you. It was set up to hinder
you. You try your hardest to work around and work within that system. And then when you see, I'm just going to throw my hands up and throw a brick through the window, then people say, why y'all doing that? I'm angry. I'm pissed off.
Well, see, it's really only two things we can really do. And that's either change the way we're looked at. And we can do that because we don't have to accept these television shows.
Sure.
If people stopped accepting these television shows and be like, no, we're not going to go on TV and look like a fool for a check. If we stop doing that, we'll be good. Or either we just leave.
Look, I mean, for me, why are we not?
Because right now in Africa, for people who have education, who they're really looking for... mechanics? I think it's mechanics.
Yeah.
They're giving them 20 acres right now and giving them jobs in Africa right now because they're trying to build their community for African-Americans who have intelligence. They ain't looking for no black people. They're looking for African-Americans.
African-Americans ain't going to Africa.
That's because y'all black people. That's why. If y'all wanted black people, y'all would go.
It's not going to happen.
It will happen.
I just think for what the professor said about African-Americans or black folk who keep preaching personal responsibility. I heard a conversation yesterday where they were talking about the idea of white privilege and how white privilege, you could be a poor white person and still have more privilege than me. We can live right next door to each other, even be roommates and be poor, and you still have more privilege than I do based off the color of your skin. Yep. So they were talking about the very idea and concept of white privilege, and this black guy said, I don't believe in that because there are certain privileges as a black man that I have that white guys don't have. That's part of the problem.
Like
you
what?
Do not recognize, okay, yeah, you know what, yeah, I can sag my pants and they can just say that's part of the hip-hop culture. That's not privilege.
I know. Privilege. Like, name one.
Privilege is being able to walk into a bank and them saying, how can I get you a loan instead of saying, I need you to leave.
Right.
Like, that's part of white privilege. So we're working within a system, again, that was set up for you to fail in the first place. So you're trying your best to work around and work within that system. And then when things go haywire, you get angry. And this is that outward showing of anger and unrest. How much angst do you have as a black man? You know what I mean? Did you ever see the Vine of that guy, that young guy that was walking around the store? He just showed the
Was funny.
Lady. Yeah, and then when he called her, she ran.
Yeah.
We're still dealing with that type of stuff. And then when we look at this, we're just like, I didn't think that type of stuff was still going on. Like, where have you been?
America doesn't, because America doesn't deal with us, generally speaking. They don't really get it. They don't understand what we're going through. And like I said, nobody's willing to, well, perhaps we are, but let's say, generally speaking, America's not willing to have that conversation because for America, it's that black stain. All they see is, man, here they go. They're going to talk about us. And, you know, it wasn't me. You know, I looked and my family ain't do none of that. So I don't know why they talking about me. So, you know, America doesn't want to have that discussion so that we can move forward. Because, like I said, I was talking to my boss one time. And we were talking about race and race in America. And I said, a lot of the problem is that we can't talk to each other and really understand it's 2014. Mm-hmm. And I understand that the opportunities that are much better than the opportunity. There is the black people in America. 50.
Absolutely.
And how they feel. And then that's the hurdle that you have to get over mm-hmm. in order to be able to talk to those individuals. We're going to have the same problem. That's why I say it's going to take it'll be another generation. You know, before we can really
it may be
get
more
that.
Than that, man.
You know,
it honestly, maybe look, we're talking about poverty numbers that matched the 1950s. We're talking about black wealth that was completely eradicated when we had the recession of 2008, 2009. So we're still trying to build back up that wealth because the wealth that we hold is in our homes. So if you no longer have that, what do you have? Then we're talking about how Malia and Sasha Obama, this is the first time you've had a black president. Well, now they have presidential privilege because of what their father was able to accomplish. Compare that to the Bush twins. They have privilege back from the 1920s. How can you catch up with that? You can't. It takes time. So you still cannot compare saying, oh, well, General Bush got a job at NBC and Malia may be able to get a job at ABC. Okay. Even without that, she still would have been able to get a job at ABC because of what her family did in the 1920s. Malia Obama, if he wouldn't have been senator and you know, head of the Harvard Law Review, that would have been like, yeah, she'd probably get an internship down there at Disney or something. But, I mean, that's it. So that's what the privilege affords you. And until we can recognize and acknowledge that. And the second thing is, if you're white and we're having a race conversation and we say, okay, this is an indictment on, don't internalize it. I'm not saying that this is about you. You don't have to internalize every single thing
that
I say. That's not necessarily about you. That's about the history that I've been faced with.
And that's why we can't have a conversation. Because
without you getting offended and internalizing
saying,
everything.
It's not me. It's not. I'm not talking to you.
Exactly.
You're not a CEO.
Exactly.
You're not the president of HR.
You're not a judge.
You're not a judge. You know, you're not making no real
move
fiscal decisions that can affect millions upon millions of people. Mm-hmm. I'm not talking about you. You know,
I'm talking about a racist system that's been in place since way before I was born.
Before you were born.
To be honest with you, who I'm talking to right now, I know you can't feel me, but you should be able to hear me a little bit.
Thank you.
You understand what I'm saying? We sitting next to each other at the same job, but saying the same crazy stuff, and we sitting looking at, are these people crazy?
Yeah, we lack way too much empathy, man. Way too much empathy. I don't know how you fix that, but I can't disagree with that, man. And until you're able to acknowledge that and stop internalizing everything.
And that's the problem. We can't have this conversation.
Yeah.
Because that's where it starts, man. We got to be able to have a conversation about how people feel, regardless of how you think they feel or how you feel about what they feel. You need to talk. You need to have a conversation with these people and recognize and figure out a way to empathize with them and then help them move on.
And you know what? For us,
beyond that, that's the key.
When you're having a conversation about race, stop trying to make white folk feel comfortable, because even no matter how much you try to soften that conversation, they're still going to feel uncomfortable anyway. So let your anger out because you're angry.
But they don't know how to handle that. That gives them, they get scared.
But you can be,
No, you can't.
You can be truthful and not, and, you know, and present it in a nice manner.
Yeah, you can. Yeah. Not when you're emotional.
Not when you're passionate.
No, not when you're emotional.
You feel passionate about how you your ancestors were treated.
Now, I know you had that conversation and weren't like, when the police got here? what's going on?
No, they here for you. We were just talking.
Oh no, Larry's going off again.
Crazy Larry. I'm pretty sure we're close on time here, so we'll wind it down, man. I want to thank Jason Henry for coming through.
Anytime, man.
Mr. King, Jeremy, Dr. Yes, Jody Armour as well. Jason, you got anything you want to plug?
Nah, man.
Nah?
I'm sure I do, but I can't think of any right now.
You can't think of nothing.
Jay Henry Project.
Yeah, always. Hyper Orlando or Little Sentinel blog. Oh, I'll be on Fox News tomorrow night, Fox 35, talking about politics, man. So, okay. 10 o'clock.
Okay. There he is, man.
Fox.
Local.
The local Fox.
Local. Not national.
Even if you was on national, let's watch it.
Yeah, we'll ride it out. Absolutely.
We got you. We got you. You can be over there with a hood on your head. That's my dog.
I don't know when he went left, but I still got it.
For sure, man. We want to thank the listeners out there. Thank you for tuning in to Real Family Talk. Again, we're here every Wednesday night right here at WOKB, your urban inspiration empowerment station. We'll see you next week. This is your host, Jay Real. Bye-bye.
Follow us on Facebook, Real Family Talk. You can follow us on Twitter, Real Family Talk. The website, realfamilytalk.weebly.com.
WOKB, Winter Garden, Orlando.
It's Gospel 1680, WOKB, your urban empowerment and inspiration station. It's about to go down in the town. Jay Real and them, boy, they shut it down in here tonight. Coming up right now, I got Pastor Tim, TPT, right here. It's all about you, Lord. It's all about you on WOKB. We going in.